asomaba, ¿no? En las primeras palabras de la vicepresidenta Calviño.
Okay, so Vice President Calviño was speaking about this vision she had of the audiovisual industry, composed or integrated, not just by its traditional backbone such as cinema, television, streaming platforms, but games, video games are also included there, immersive contents as well. And here we were also talking about the importance of stories. How our raw material in this industry are stories to tell, and stories travel through many different platforms, stories end up being video games, or the other way around, video games end up being series. And of course, we should be talking about the importance of literature as a source for the audiovisual sector. So we are going to be talking about all that, about this double journey, that cooperation between different formats and different methods of telling stories, moderated by our dear colleague.
Pues, si queréis, Javier y Verónica, como sois los primeros, empezáis aquí y vamos por orden. Hola. Bueno, empezamos ya.
So let's start. Good morning. Thank you so much, the organizers, for having organized this event to talk about European audiovisual sector. Thank you very much, dear speakers, for being here. In this round table, we are going to be talking about how the collaboration between industries, between formats, between different sectors, how that collaboration makes it possible for us to go beyond, to reach a bigger size in our project and to reach more and better audiences. In this round table, we are going to be having Javier Castillo, the writer, and also Verónica Fernández, director, Content Originals, Spain Netflix. We will be talking about this Snow Girl. Also Daniel Sánchez Mateos and Nico Maggi. Nico, he's the co-founder of Lightbox Studios. We will be talking to them. And Yolanda del Val Gilabert, who is the head of the fiction department in Dea Planeta. And Marie-Laure Monteroni, EVP International from Pathé Films. We'll be talking about the co-production of D'Artagnan films. So without any further ado, let's watch also another video. Let's start with this Snow Girl, La Chica de Nieve. It is subtitled.
La tenacidad. Las ganas de poner las cosas en su sitio por muy difíciles que parezcan.
Bien, todos sabéis quién es Amaya Martín, la niña desaparecida, ¿no?
¡Amaya!
No sabemos dónde está Amaya, ¿no? No sabemos qué va a ser de ella y nos tememos lo peor.
Si hay algo de lo que entiendo es el mono. Quiero ayudarte a encontrar a tu hija. Y si publicáis cualquier cosa que ponga nervioso al secuestrador, será la niña quien lo pague.
Hace 2 años la policía no hizo por mí una mierda. No me ayudasteis. ¿Vais a hacer lo mismo también a esa familia?
Nos gustaría anunciar que ofrecemos 100.000 euros a quien aporte cualquier pista que nos lleve hasta Amaya.
Llevo 6 años con este caso. Lo único que quiero es encontrar a la niña.
¿Ha llegado esto para ti?
¡Está viva!
¿Por dónde empezamos?
Por el principio.
Recordad, buscamos cualquier indicio de la niña, peina toda la casa.
Todas nosotras sabemos qué aspecto tiene un monstruo. Detrás de cada sonrisa bonita, están ahí. Nos asusta, nos da miedo.
Alguien tiene que seguir buscando a Amaya.
que crees que está viva. ¡Dilo!
Bueno, me ha llevado a cuando me...
En parte particular de la chica de nieve.
The Snow Javier, Girl that I love.
Javier, Verónica, will you do that again?
Bueno,
are you going to repeat? Well, yes.
The truth is that
a few months ago we announced that the story continues. It is a story which is based upon a book, and then there is a second book. And I think that seeing the success we've had with the Snow Girl, so we saw that this is a unique opportunity because there is that second book, and to do that with Netflix, which was always a dream for us. Because when you write, when you are a writer, you do not think that you can reach that far. And then when you are told that you it has been seen in 190 countries, I don't know how many users, you are in shock. And then as a writer, as an author, that makes it possible for you to set a foot in different countries where you were not publishing. I am lucky because my books were already being read and translated in many different countries, but through Netflix, through this huge window, everything has got faster, has got accelerated, and my books are being translated into 27 languages, published in 85 different countries. I already had 10, but I have been able to add 15 further countries thanks to Netflix. Yes, you as an author, that has had an impact just with this book, or also has it had an impact for your other books? Well, it depends. In different countries, they see my name and they say, what has he already written? And some people say, I'm going to read the first one. And they start by the beginning, other people go to the last one, but your name is already in their mind, and already they know that, well, that they know, or I know that I am writing universal stories which are understood beyond our borders. So that is very important for me. I want to share universal feelings that can be understood, with which people can have empathy in other world. And in the case of the Snow Girl, everything happens in the US, but it has been shot in Spain, and it could have been produced in Korea. So then the plot would have been just as successful. Maybe you have to do certain little adaptations in Korea, for example. I mean, we would have had to adapt it a little bit, but we need to identify that commonality, that common element that we can all identify. So that has been very important for me. It has taken me far away. Veronica, when you adapt literary work, what is the most difficult thing? Yes, working with the author must be the most difficult thing. Well, in our case, in the case of La Chica de Nieve, the Snow Girl, there is something that he has omitted, he hasn't said, and it is that it was the book that was read by more people all through the pandemic here in Spain. There were many people, you know, The Snow Girl was read by many, many people all through the pandemic during the lockdown. So this book, from the very beginning, we knew that, you know, many different people, different ages and different audiences could understand it and connect with it and be moved. Yes, it has been understood here, but also in the US. So the most difficult thing is to identify the vision. Javier and other authors, they write their stories just as they are in their mind, but then they are going to be turned into something different, into an audiovisual work, and it is impossible to translate it directly, you know, from the literary terms into the audiovisual terms. So also to identify the team so as to preserve the best from the book is essential, so as to adapt it and so as to translate it into that other language. That is the most difficult thing. Here we have had the team coming from Jesús and Andrés, who did an incredible work, and we also had the chance to have Javier,
so that the book, the work didn't lose its essence, and so that it could keep on moving people. For me, that is the most important thing. Very often we are given a book, a novel, and it is marvelous, but we say, but then how can we translate it into something audiovisual? It's been very easy to work with him. He understood from the very beginning that what we were going to be doing was something different. It was going to be turned into something different. Okay, so the adaptation, it is true that there were certain commonalities, certain common elements that would have to change. For example, we wanted the production to take place in Spain. And for example, the journalist at a certain point in the US, she buys a gun. But here, of course, in Spain, this is impossible. You cannot go and buy a gun. So you need to adapt it so that it can be understood. The same thing happens, but with little modifications. And if all that has been well thought of, there's no problem. And there is something essential. When I see different adaptations now that we are working with two other books, we always try to maintain, preserve the soul, the essence of the story. And then there are certain superficial elements where you can use certain tricks, just like with a thriller, and you can exchange them and change them, but you cannot lose the soul. And Atípica, the whole team, Jesús and Javier, they understood that from the very beginning, and it was very easy to work in a team so as to identify the common language between literature and the audiovisual sector, and all that in Malaga, rainy Malaga. You know, Malaga in the south, we are supposed, I mean, we always think about Malaga being shiny. I come from Malaga. And it is true that, you know, that is why maybe we decided to shoot it there. Where should we shoot it? And the more we were thinking about Malaga, the easier the decision was, because we had the port, the harbor, but also the landscape, the fields, and Christmas is very important. I apologize with people coming from Vigo, but well, never mind. We don't have as many lights as in Vigo, but we have many different ingredients to make it happen successfully. Well, also as an excuse, you know, I was local, so I could go peep in and go and follow the shooting. Well, yes, it was a joint decision. For us, it was only evident that we wanted to tell a local story. We wanted to be local somehow. That Spain that is in our mind, we wanted to convey and to show the real Spain and to go to the best place. So in this case, maybe the story was asking or calling us to go to the US. But I think it was beautiful because everybody in Malaga, people were great, fantastic. The film commission, they were so helpful, and the shooting was great. Then everybody says, in Malaga, that's not true. It doesn't rain as much as what you show. It's right. It is true that it was raining a lot that week. Okay, so it is true that here we can shoot anything, any kind of story. It is true that sometimes there are prejudices or stereotypes. That rainy Malaga, it's true that we are not used to seeing Malaga as a rainy city, but it was successful. Yes, and the fact of working in Malaga helped people all over the world to see a different city, a different Malaga, because, you know, different tourist guides have been prepared so as to follow exactly what we were doing, where we were shooting. So I think that that has been beautiful as well, being able to give and offer that present to my city. And having been able to travel abroad with all that. Veronica, please, when you shoot in Spain, which are the positive and the negative things? Which are the challenges and the opposite? And why can it be easier? Yes, many things have been helpful. The fact of having the film commission there supporting us all the time was very helpful, because we were able to shoot in different locations, but also city hall, city councils were supporting us all the time. We were given that support. We had that framework. You know, the government was supporting us. They understood that ours is a strategic business, because here we are the creativity head or experts, but it is true that having the right conditions to develop our productions anywhere in Spain is very helpful. That institutional support is essential for our industry. It can be better, of course, and it could be better, but I think that we are on the right path. We are on the right path. I am thinking about how the industry was 10 years ago, and I think that today conditions have got better because we are considered differently. And there's no girl here. We are two of us, but there are 150 people behind who have been working. Malaga, the extra people, the whole city has been there. We are in an industry generating wealth, generating employment, and for me that is the most important thing. And then we could be talking about other things if you want, but that is essential. And last, before I give the floor to Tadeo Jones, before we speak about Tadeo Jones, in the audiovisual tradition, the adaptation of novels, of books, well, it is not the first time, but it is true that we have new series formats which permit different cooperations, different collaborations. In terms of the collaboration between books and series, please, what would you highlight? What can you tell us? What is the best element in this collaboration? Well, in my case, it is true that it opens up a huge window. But for somebody like me, I am a highly creative person. It is true that I have so many stories in my mind, but I cannot develop all of them. So I have got to know a new industry, a new way of sharing your stories with people in a different way. And even if literature is highly powerful, the audiovisual world has its own components, because there is music, photography, so many different elements are contained there, and that is why viewers can connect in a different way, in a highly powerful way, with our stories, with our creations. So it's beautiful being able to merge, to join that world. And I think that that is something essential for any creator, because what, at the end of the day, the goal is to move people. And I know that I am going to be able to reach and move even more people. To give some figures, the books have been read by 1 million people, and then the series have been watched by, you know, that has been multiplied by 10. So whatever we believe in is being shared with many, many more people, and then it is great to be able to work with a team such as this one, who are always listening to you. They do not just purchase by the rights and then they do whatever they want. No, they, from the very beginning, they wanted me to be happy and to be successful as well, and at the same time they told me, we want to end up doing something representing also you. So what a beautiful partnership between the author and the scriptwriters and producers.
I have to look for the best stories wherever they are, and sometimes they are in publishing houses that are doing a nice work as well, and sometimes it's elsewhere. So I believe this collaboration that started a long time ago between books and cinema is a collaboration that is feeding each other, that is making us grow. And I think the visibility that the series has given to the book is wonderful. More people have read the book due to that, and on the other way around, people that have read the book go and watch the series. So I think this collaboration is healthy, it's enriching, and I think that all the publishing houses we work with are happy whenever we start with such a collaboration, and they can help us to choose the right stories as well. So this is where we have to look. Thank you very much. I love the series, really. Hello, Nico and Daniel. We're going to talk about the great phenomenon of Spanish animation, Tadeo Jones. Nico is the producer and the founder of Lightbox Studios. And Nico Tadeo-Jones started in 2012. It's 2023 now. The story is long, very interesting. You have broken every barrier in Spanish animation, in format, in public figures, in everywhere that you were able to reach. So tell us about it. It's very funny that you said that Tadeo-Jones was born in 2012. It was in 22. Entonces, ha sido un viaje muy largo, so it's been a long, long road, and it has been very fast, though. Animation is a very slow process, as you know, and if you have to learn about the business along the way, as we did, it makes it even longer. So imagine, I met Enrique Gato on the internet, because he was uploading his short films on the internet, and I watched them, and it sounds weird because nowadays it is very easy thanks to YouTube, but we didn't have YouTube at that time. And at that time he was already developing video games in 3D, and many people that were 3D developers had downloaded his video games to see how it was being done, because it was groundbreaking. So everybody was working at home in a very primitive way, so to say. And at the beginning, the idea was to develop a short film, and the short film worked okay. And that was the head of the project. And then we started imagining, what if we shoot a feature film? Well, let's start with a comic book, and then we can translate the comic book into a film, a 50-minute film, and then let's do a short film again. And then 6 years have gone by, and all of a sudden, we had the financing to shoot the big feature film. And of course, every producer tells me you cannot start shooting unless you have 30% of the budget ready. But in that case, we would have never started. So we shot the film, and it took us 4 years until we had the whole money that we needed. And then we started with the first drawing for the film. And then we were aware that we were not Pixar, so we wanted to do something different. And it was a great success. And curiously, it was a great success because Spain was in the middle of a crisis. And so there was no publicity, there were no adverts on television. And Mediaset said, okay, let's have earnings through another means. And so they started a great campaign, an unprecedented one. And on top of that, our team won the European Football Cup. So it was, everything was amazing. And everything was very big. And then we were very lucky as well. We were like very lucky because luck came when we were already working, of course. And then someone said, a video game. And all of a sudden it was not possible, but they wanted a video game straight away. So how can you develop a video game straight away? So we tried to reconvert something that we had for the film. And that first video game, Tadeo video game, because now we are at edition 4, we have 4 Tadeo video games. The first one was a kind of reconversion, and we had 400,000 downloads for free, and 7 paid downloads. And so Tadeo continued to develop and develop, and here we are. We're going to start the fourth part, and we have already issued a fourth video game with Daniel. And there are also musicals for Tadeo and with zero cost. And then Daniel Sánchez arrives, and he is a very experienced person in the sector of video games in this country, and he has a studio that is specialized in collaboration with cultural businesses. He has worked with museums, with television and cinema proposals, and you much. Well, it was a long way as well. Our studio is very small, and we always liked hybrids. We always liked to give opportunities to people because the video game world is still unknown. Nobody knows how you develop a video game, what are the steps, and although everybody knows what a video game is. So we cooperated with PlayStation for a long time, and that way we entered the worldwide market, and then we issued the film, the Tadeo film, and then in the past, we worked with Uplay, developing games for PlayStation 4, and we started developing the game for PlayStation 4, but with the new environment. And so we learned a lot of things on the way, how it is to work with the animation industry, because it is different, because in a video game we tell a different story and we tell it in a different way as in an animation film. And we were not looking for a replica of the film. We wanted to create something that added value to the brand. And so after 1 year production, when the film was brought to the theaters, we wanted to arrive at the same time. We wanted to issue our video game at the same day that the film was going to be shown in theaters. And in the end, we had PlayStation 4, PlayStation 5, Nintendo in March. So it's been a great work. And it helped us a lot because Tadeo films are always brought to the theaters in the last weekend of August, right before the youngsters go back to school. And it's still being shown in January, which is not bad. It's not bad. You can imagine that other films don't last that long. But we invest a lot at the beginning, and when the film has been shown for 6 weeks, we have to find another way to keep it going. And so the video game is helping us to take impulse again. And it's very nice, because if we didn't have the video game, we would go from a lot of visitors to the theater, a great public in the 6 week, to zero. And how can you bring all that together, the video game, the film and everything? How can you follow the video game and follow the film, and how does the audience respond in comparison to other video game projects with 2,000 million downloads in the first day? Well, in reality, it is like a coin with two sides. The reality, the environment is similar in the film and in the video game. So, because we are trying to approach the Tadeo public, which is not particularly children. There are children, but there are adults as well. And then we have another challenge, because if you prepare a children video game and they go then to the film, your market reduces. And Tadeo was born in Spain, but there are a lot of countries that relate to that, and because you know it's going to work there, like Latin America. And you are entering a market where the US is king and master. And so you have to think very thoroughly what is your public, what is the audience you're targeting. And we understood that. So we tried not to infantilize the video game a lot. So the video games were very simple at the beginning with just jumping and moving forward, but we tried to approach an older public, and we complicated the game a bit. And we were able to combine the 3D in an open environment with 2D scenarios where you get the fights. And that's that added a new layer to the game. And at the beginning I was scared to get into the project because the film was such a success. But we think we have found the formula. Tadeo was always a dream, but was always thought to work in Spain and Latin America. And we achieved that goal, but the greatest test was to use a different name. We have Tat of the Explorers, and despite us renaming the film in English, everybody calls it Tadeo. Wherever I go, it is Tadeo. It's not Tadeus or Tat or whatever. So we have a business model, a financing model, and a market. And if we speak only about figures that allow us to be present at that market, and we move in that environment, it's okay. To come to an end, from the point of view of production, my impression is that the audiovisual sector is a bit unknowledgeable about timing and the characteristics of animation production and video game production. So one question I have is, can you share part of the production? I think you approached it before. Can you share scenarios and characters? Can you do you start the design phase together so that you can use resources from both areas? Well, it would be nice to do it so it would be more agile, but what we have is a finished product. So I thought at the beginning that we had a model that was developed for the film, and I would give it to Daniel, and as in magical movement, it would be good for video games. And it's not like that. Yes, it's not like that. The art that was produced for the film, we have to use different technologies to use those models for the video games, but they are different models. We need to use different formats, and the narration is very different, narrative. The best idea would be to have a very interactive project that could combine film and video game, and you can design it from the production point of view, but this is a dream. It's not possible. Usually the film is already finished, and I believe when we started to produce the video games, you were already testing the film, but it was not finished yet, and so we still had time to decide some things. And the synchronization with the film was very good. Yes, but allow me to repeat myself. Many things that we use are not usable for video games because I can move I don't know how many polygons by second, and in the film you cannot, and it's the light is different. It's very different. You're using natural lights in real time, and we don't. And in the video game, for example, we use frames from the film for, as a scenario, but to get the same light as in the film took us a while, really. If you watch the film and the video game, you see that scenarios are similar. So we are very happy with that. The solution was good. So give us 5 years and we talk again. And curiously, it's the industry, the film industry, that is going to evolve, because we're starting to do animation films with video game engines. Yes, we always talk about audiovisual and film, but it's one industry, and the production models and even the selling models are taking over from one part of the industry to the next. So, because sometimes in animation it's very, very logical. If you want to produce something in real time, as we do in video games, this is something that will move over to the film industry, to animation. Thank you very much. And finally, we have talked about cooperation models between culture and series, how to cooperate between video games and animation. And now we're going to talk about the cooperation through co-production. We have Yolanda and Marilo with us, and they are going to talk about the great production of D'Artagnan. I don't know if you watch it. Marilo is going to start. It's the Three Musketeers. D'Artagnan is the first part of the trilogy.
Yes, we'd like to speak about famous French and Spanish co-production, The Three Musketeers. Maybe some of you in the room have seen it. It's a film in two parts. It's a very ambitious film, and I wanted to briefly explain why we wanted to dig into this property. Actually, it's really the French richness of books and universe that we decided to dig into, and it would be a shame not to, because it's so rich and so large. And this one is in the public domain, and we thought the Alexandre Dumas universe was really very, very rich and so ambitious that even though it has been adapted many, many times in the past in various languages, that is in French, in English, in Italian, in Russian, etc., we wanted this time to do a more modern and more pacey and more vivid adaptation of it. And to do that, we shot for 28 weeks. We shot in 60 different locations. It was all in natural set. It was all shot in France, thanks to which we obtained some French subsidies that were essential for it. And of course, we went to our obvious European partners, and to begin with Dea Planeta, with whom we've been collaborating in the past for decades, and with whom we thought there was an obvious and common vision for the films. And we would like to unveil the trailer for those who are not familiar with the footage.
Voici donc les diables que je dois gronder.
Excusez-moi. Vous croyez que cela va suffire?
On ne se fait pas justice soi-même.
C'était un peu plus gras, celui-là, j'en rechais rien.
C'est un droit qui m'appartient à moi. Et à moi seul. Qui est cet enfant?
D'Artagnan, votre majesté.
Trois duels en trois heures avec trois mousquetaires.
Monsieur Athos a le droit de me tuer en premier, Monsieur Porthos en second et Aramis en dernier.
Je le trouve bien arrogant, jeune homme.
C'est ma seule richesse. Et je la mets tout entière au service de sa majesté. Charles D'Artagnan.
J'ai bien connu votre père. Que puis-je faire pour son fils?
Aussi loin que je me souvienne, j'ai toujours voulu être mousquetaire.
Vous allez rejoindre les cadets. Et peut-être un jour, vous serez mousquetaire.
Ils sont sept, nous sommes trois. Il me semble à moi que nous sommes quatre.
Tu veux pas le juger, s'il te plaît? Il m'exaspère.
Cette rivalité entre nos troupes est ridicule.
Retenez vos soldats, je retiens dans la lumière.
Milady. Des difficultés.
Morte et enterrée.
On ne peut pas laisser faire ça.
Mais il est innocent.
Vous voulez donc que je déclare la guerre aux protestants et à l'Angleterre?
Le cardinal fera tout pour faire tomber la reine.
Pour qui travaillez-vous, madame?
Le diable, probablement.
For us, it's a very ambitious production. It made sense to collaborate for the project. And most of what we're going to approach now has been mentioned already in the previous panel. but we have very, very strong IPs in Europe. We also have books that are very powerful, and we have many, many stories in Europe. And so we believe that there is a thirst for everything that is European, European films, ambitious projects. And in this sense, we are always looking for not only European films that have a low, medium budget, but when Epaté talked to us and presented this project, we thought that it was the right one. And so we're very happy to have worked with it. This co-production is not the only one. There are so many co-productions in Europe that are working, that are functioning well, that they are being sold out. And we had the problem with the pandemics, but the recovery has been very good. This is an exceptional year. And of course, we won't get to the level that we had in 2019. That was exceptionally good. But this year, Super Mario, Barbie's Oppenheimer is really bringing life back to the industry and to us as independent distributors, because we want to have our doors open, and therefore we need to offer the public quality products, European quality products, with medium budget, with high budget. So,
it was also essential for the film to be able to travel and to exist really across all borders, to have some very famous and timely cast. So, of course, we got Vincent Cassel, Vicky Creeps, Eva Green, and that's also an essential asset in order to have those films travel internationally and try and compete towards the US productions. So, we were really super proud to have that. A big European production that traveled and that performed pretty well all around the world.
And you're French.
Jan previously said that maybe French. But no, I think that he was mentioning the French series. But no, I think that the French subsidies are incredible and they are supporting.
No, of course, yeah, industry. We're totally aware that the French system is pretty generous in order to make those films happen, but it's not sufficient, so that's why we have to knock at various doors, and Spain is one of them, and we have needed them in the past and we'll need them in the future. On this one in particular, we also have Constantine in Germany that went on board at an early stage, and we want to keep on doing some eventful movies, and we will need our European partners for that, and Dea Planeta is among them.
Y este es el camino, ¿no?
And this is a way. This is the way to be able to have enough budget to shoot big films through co-production. And of course, I don't want to go into the small details of your contract, your cooperation contract, but I would like to know how this cooperation started, how it was generated between your two businesses, and what are the positive aspects, and what was the largest challenge that you met?
Pretty natural collaboration, because we've known one another for a certain amount of years. Dea Planeta has distributed a bunch of Pathé films in the past, and that, to mention just a few, La Petite Famille, a big Danny Boone production, but also some smaller ones like Paris Memories or L'Immensità. We have many together. We've been working together for a long time. We share the same vision. So it was both pretty natural and easy to work together. Not to go into details, it's just a matter of a portion of the budget. So the mm-hmm. budget is a high production budget, as you all understood, and each territory that comes early on stage brings a portion of the budget.
De cara, como estamos en una jornada europea,
since this is a European meeting, I would like to write a letter to Santa Claus and see what we need in Europe, to be better in co-production. What would you add to this Santa Claus list? What is your wish so that co-production gets better in Europe?
To have conversations at early stages, at script stages, to decide together the cast crew, to be able to include sometimes some Spanish cast, for instance. That could be something to be able sometimes, if it's relevant, of course, to shoot in some regions of Spain in order to achieve a bigger portion of the budget.
Vale. Y desde tu punto de vista,
lo mismo. A ver, no, yo creo que...
Well, I do believe that we can always get better. We can start earlier, but it is difficult to take decisions as big as these ones on an early stage because we don't co-produce from day one. There is usually a certain development done already, and of course, the earlier we can start co-producing, the better. In that sense, to be able to accelerate the decision path of institutions could help us a lot. But we are achieving it. And for future developments, what is the day after? Dumas is going to continue. There are many Dumases. There is Dumas, there is Julius Berner. There are so many good writers in France, and they in France they are used to adopt those novels to the cinema, and we are very happy to cooperate with them. So, are you thinking maybe of jumping to other formats like video games? Well, we are already actively producing series with Televisión Española. We are co-producing with other television channels that were in the previous panel. And in that sense, with Pathé, we have started to talk about this because they are starting to produce series now. Who knows?
We opened up our TV division pretty recently, but we're definitely having some conversations together.
Muy bien. Pues, ¿queréis añadir?
Would you like to add something? Or can we open the mic to the public? 1 second. Microphone, please.
El señor de la camisa
blanca. Hi. A very quick question for Marilor and Yolanda. How would you judge the box office for Three Musketeers, D'Artagnan, in France and outside France? I know it went very well in France, but my question is, outside France, were you looking for more? And also, is the value now of such big series, films such as this, which had great reviews, is the value going up in any way in TV, where a lot of the biggest broadcasters in Europe are trying to fire up VOD services and play VOD linear? And this seems to me to be a kind of flagship entity, but if you can comment.
Yes, well, the French success was huge. It achieved 3,400,000 admissions just in France. And internationally, we achieved 1,600,000. And this brings a total of more than 35 million box office worldwide. So it is a big number. So international sales for this, both pre-sales and sales on those two films, were very solid. And as we all know, the films do not only have a theatrical life. This is only the first cycle. Then, of course, it goes to SVOD and to pay TV and to free TV and to TVOD, etc. And this is where, in some territories, the bigger portion of the revenues are. Does that answer your question? I think it does.
Thank you.
¿Alguna pregunta más?
Any other? Any further questions?
Aquí hay una...
I think that we have been talking also all the time about IP, intellectual property. Tadeo is a beautiful example about something that was launched in the year 2002, and then it has been adopted by many different formats. It has ended up being video games because they have the capability to do so. So what about the future? More and more, a film can end up being a video game, just as with the Three Musketeers or the Snow Girl. I don't know if that could be turned into a video game. Why not? But it could end up being into other platforms. So please tell us about IP and other platforms. When we did the Tadeo's short, the very first short film, which was finished in November 2004, back then we thought about the registration. We wanted to register the trademark, and being the owners of that, of the trademark, is very important. So what is the importance of IPs? Well, I started in 2002, and now when we're going to be releasing Tadeo 4, it will be in 2026. So 4 years of hard work, self-generated for our company, and each project implies that we are employing 250 people. People, 150 people. So this versus not having the IP and access to services, that defines a huge difference. Because making a series out of Tadeo Jones, well, the idea is always there, lingering in the air. But, you know, I am a cinema person, and I get TV producers who say to me, no, sell it to us, we will make it happen. And then suddenly you have another venue of revenues with which you were not counting on. So if you want to set foot on this industry, we need to protect IPs. And to protect the IP first, you need to create it. And to do so, we need the support of the national players. Something that we find is that Spanish television has a certain quota for animation projects and the ECAA as well, but we do not find the same support coming from private players. And it is not, I shouldn't be saying that, because Tadeo wouldn't have been born without Mediaset, but it would be much more beautiful if there were animation projects being launched one after the other. And that's important as well. Thank you. Thank you. Spanish animation, you know, is being so successful lately. We have Sultana, the travel of the Sultana, being released or premiered here. So yes, we would like to encourage more animation creators. Okay, one last question, maybe. Thank you.
From the Croatian Audiovisual Center. On co-productions, or cooperation as it was called on the earlier panel, I think there's a disconnect for smaller countries to be able to scale up and work with larger countries in co-production. We don't have the resources. So companies like Beta, who were on the previous panel, who are finding models to associate smaller countries with larger projects that can then be co-produced with larger players, I think is very important and should be encouraged by the Commission. And on the IP retention issue, clearly we have to be able to retain at least IP proportionate to the investment and risk taken by the investors in the investing countries. It's not possible to be forced to give up that IP. I wanted to ask a question on the link between games and animation and films, because we're now in the process of producing a children's film and at the same time a game. And we have the same creative team, at least in terms of authors and script writers, working on the project already at the development stage. I'm wondering if any of you have any experience where you have really both products being both the film and the game being developed simultaneously.
Well, to try and some, yes. We do not have that much time. Well, in fact, producing a video game, thinking about, for example, children, audience, having them in mind, implies limiting ourselves. We always think that the children audience, when we talk about video games, can also be scalable. All that depends upon the type of game. So when we are thinking about producing an animation film, we need also to understand what the film wants to convey, what and where and to whom. And like that, we will be able to transfer that to the platform or to the specific video game genre. So I don't know if I am replying, but it is very important to identify what you want to tell, if you have the IP and if you can respect the IP in any format, but you also need to adapt to your audience. How could that audience receive the video game? The only difference is that here we are not talking about a national market. And I think that I would like to add something. We are not even saying that gamers are going to be thinking if the game is a Spanish European or not. We appreciate that very much. They are not playing a video game because it comes from this country or another. If the you are not buying this video game because it's American or because it is not, or I am not playing this because it is Spanish. And we said, what? Sorry, why aren't you playing? Video games world has other barriers, but many doors can be opened when you work with other licenses and with IPs. It is true that before Netflix, mainly, there were cultural barriers in terms of what we were doing, and the nationality of the film could play an important role, but today they do not exist any longer. So to keep on releasing a film in the US in movie theaters, and they protect their market a lot, it is very difficult and very expensive, but the success of Spanish productions there, such as, for example, La Casa de Papel, Money Heist, or El Hoyo, that is an example that shows that all those barriers have been demolished. And Yankees, American people, they are getting used to reading subtitles. Yes. So the vision series, it is true that there is that level of protectionism, but with a video game you have a huge market. Well, thank you very much to all of you. I hope that there will be more and more cooperation between different formats, different countries, different industries. Thanks. Thank you very much. Now let's go for a coffee.